Well, this evening, let me invite you to turn in your copy of God's Word to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. 1 Corinthians chapter 14. And if you're following along in the Pew Bible, at least in most of the Pew Bibles, you should find that on page 1115. I really wrestled this past week in preparation for this sermon with how much to cover. As I was studying, I kind of regretted the fact that we didn't go a little bit further 2 weeks ago. The first point of the sermon, in many ways, is going to reiterate some of what we saw last time, but I just couldn't let it go. We needed to cover it. Maybe it's a little OCD making sure we get every verse in. So we will be covering quite a bit tonight, and I will be summarizing, but I do intend to complete chapter 14. So you will need to have your Bibles open to follow along for that. Be reminded of the context. Last time we noted that Paul was introducing the topic of speaking in tongues and prophecy, correcting the church for their overemphasis on speaking in tongues without an interpreter because no one could understand. So let's pick up in verse 12, and then we'll read through the end of the chapter. Verse 12 begins, "So it is with you, since you are eager to have spiritual gifts, try to excel in gifts that build up the church. For this reason, anyone who speaks in a tongue should pray that he may interpret what he says. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. So what shall I do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will also pray with my mind. I will sing with my spirit, but I will also sing with my mind. If you are praising God with your spirit, how can one who finds himself among those who do not understand say amen to your thanksgiving, since he does not know what you are saying? You may be giving thanks well enough, but the other man is not edified. I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you, but in the church I would rather speak 5 intelligible words to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. Brothers, stop thinking like children. In regard to evil, be infants, but in your thinking, be adults. In the law, it is written, through men of strange tongues and through lips of foreigners, I will speak to this people, but even then they will not listen to me, says the Lord. Tongues, then, are a sign not for believers, but for unbelievers. Prophecy, however, is for unbelievers, or rather for believers, not for unbelievers. So if the whole church comes together and everyone speaks in tongues, and some who do not understand or some unbelievers come in, will they not say that you are out of your mind? But if an unbeliever or someone who does not understand comes in while everybody is prophesying, he will be convinced by all that he is a sinner and will be judged by all, and the secrets of his heart will be laid bare. So he will fall down and worship God, exclaiming, God is really among you. What then shall we say, brothers? When you come together, everyone has a hymn or a word of instruction, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation. All of these must be done for the strengthening of the church. If anyone speaks in a tongue, 2 or at most 3 should speak, 1 at a time, and someone must interpret. If there is no interpreter, the speaker should keep quiet in the church and speak to himself and to God. 2 or 3 prophets should speak, and the others should weigh carefully what is said. And if a revelation comes to someone who is sitting down, the first speaker should stop, for you can all prophesy in turn so that everyone may be instructed and encouraged. The spirits of prophets are subject to the control of prophets, for God is not a God of disorder, but of peace. As in all the congregations of the saints, women should remain silent in the churches. They are not allowed to speak, but must be in submission as the law says. If they want to inquire about something, they should ask their own husbands at home, for it is disgraceful for a woman to speak in the church. Did the word of God originate with you, or are you the only people it has reached? If anybody thinks he is a prophet or spiritually gifted, let him acknowledge that what I am writing to you is the Lord's command. If he ignores this, he himself will be ignored. Therefore, my brothers, be eager to prophesy, and do not forbid speaking in tongues, but everything should be done in a fitting and orderly way." And there ends the reading of God's holy word. And let's once again pray for God the Spirit to bless the preaching of the word. Our great God and our Heavenly Father, we come before you tonight because you are a God who speaks. You are a God who has caused this very word to be written down by God the Holy Spirit so long ago, inspired for our edification. And so, Father, as we come into a difficult text, in many ways a confusing text, Father, we pray, first of all, that you would bless your speaker. Father, speak through him that it would be your words, that they would be understandable and clear. And, Father, above that, we pray that you would apply these words to our heart. And as we go from here, we would rejoice in the truth that they proclaim of Christ our Savior. And we do ask this in Christ's name alone. Amen. Well, in the years that I worked in construction with my dad, one of the things he taught me, or one of the principles that he drove home, was to always leave the job site at night the way we found it, to pick up, to sweep if necessary, but especially to organize everything, to pick all of our tools up, to put them in a corner if we were able to do that, or to haul them out to the truck. And part of the reason for this, or at least the reasons he gave to me as I picked up, was on the one hand to benefit others. We knew that there were other contractors coming in, whether it was electricians or plumbers, and he argued that we needed to keep things organized so that they would do their job quickly, they would be able to be more productive, and likely as well to encourage them to be organized as well, to keep things clean. But he also said we had to do this for the sake of the one who owns the home, whether it was a new home or an addition. We knew the homeowners would come on scene, and so he wanted to always make sure as best as we could to keep the place organized. Well, tonight, as we come to 1 Corinthians 14, there's a sense in which that's the principle Paul has in mind. As he writes to the church in Corinth, he says, you are to keep everything in the house of God organized. How you conduct yourself in worship, Paul says, matters. As we've been seeing in our study of this book, Paul has much to correct this church about, but especially now, he has to correct them about how they are worshiping God on Sunday. As we've been noting, the use of spiritual gifts in this time in church history, God had allotted speaking in tongues and prophecy for the building up of the church. If you were here 2 weeks ago, we noted that to the best of our ability, prophecy was a spoken word of God in that day and age before Scripture was finalized. But as well, speaking in tongues was likely speaking in a foreign language, a word of prophecy, a word of encouragement that was given during this early church history. And at this time, God allowed people, or the purpose was for them to stand up, give this word, and it would have been like a sermon or a word of encouragement that would have built the church up. Well, Paul now has to say to this church that when they gather together, there needs to be an order of worship, that they had to have an orderliness about it, because without orderliness, it doesn't benefit others, and it doesn't glorify the owner of the church, God himself. In fact, as we end the text, you notice there's two words of encouragement that our worship reflect in orderliness of God's character. And so how we worship matters. We are to be organized to benefit those who are in attendance and to glorify God. Now, just by way of reminder where we are at in this, in chapters 12 through 13, Paul is dealing with the gifts of the Spirit. And the church in Corinth wasn't doing well with this. We noted in chapter 12, they were using spiritual gifts to exalt themselves, and Paul had to correct them. Spiritual gifts are meant to serve the rest of the body. This church was using gifts to divide, to exalt themselves. That's why chapter 13, we noted spiritual gifts were to be done with love. Everything is to be done in love, and this church was not loving one another. They were exalting themselves. And last time we noted that primarily they were focused on speaking in tongues because they thought that was the pinnacle of spiritual experience. And so they were pushing and shoving their way without an interpreter to give a word from God that was not intelligible. And Paul says you got to stop doing that. If it's not intelligible, it doesn't build up the church, and therefore you need to focus on prophecy. So with that by way of introduction then, here are the 3 points, with God's help, I hope to show you tonight. First of all, we need to know orderliness for the benefit of others, for the benefit of others. Secondly, for the benefit of outreach. And then thirdly, for the benefit of order. And each of those points really could be their own, well, not really their own sermon. There wasn't enough there for me to do that, but there's different topics in those 3 points. So benefit of others, benefit of outreach, and then benefit of order. First of all then, notice with me the argument for the benefit of others. And in many ways, Paul's repeating what we saw last time. But notice verse 13. for the benefit of others, we need to pray, or that Paul says you are to pray for the gift of interpretation. Paul says in verse 13, for this reason, anyone who speaks in a tongue should pray that he may interpret what he says. When Paul says for this reason, he's harkening back to what we ended with the fact that if you speak in a tongue in this foreign language that no one understands, and if no interpreter is present, you're just making a bunch of noise. You're like a battle trumpet that's not giving distinct commands, running the army amok. You're like an instrument, a flute or a harp that's not playing a distinct note, so it's not music. It's just a bunch of noise. And Paul says, for this reason, if God has given you the gift of speaking in tongues and no one else is able to interpret what you have to say, Paul says, your job now is to pray that God would give you the gift of interpretation. A foreign language, an intelligible language, will benefit no one. So Paul says, in order to be able to use this gift, you need to pray for the ability to interpret it. Now, notice the reasons for this. One, without your own understanding, you are not able to comprehend what you're saying yourself. Look at verse 14 and 15. Paul says, for if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. What shall I do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will also pray with my mind. I will sing with my spirit, but I will also sing with my mind. Paul here says, if you don't have the gift of interpretation, you may be praising God in your spirit because you're being used to say a bunch of words, but your mind is not engaged. And therefore, if you don't have the gift of interpretation, you are not comprehending yourself the message God has given. But even more than that, without the gift of interpretation, no one can join in affirming what you said. Look at verse 16. He says, if you are praising God with your spirit, how can one who finds himself among those who do not understand say amen to your thanksgiving, since he does not know what you are saying? Again, that reminds us what we saw last time. Paul says, you may be praising God, you may be in a worshipful moment, but no one else, when you're done speaking, is able to say amen because they have no idea what you've just said. By the time you sit down, the only thing people are able to say is, wow, that was exciting, but no one can say amen because they cannot comprehend the message God was speaking through that person. So Paul says, if you love others and you have this gift, you must pray and seek out the gift to interpret it for the people. And he says this because, again, there's no benefit in understanding. Look at verse 17. He says, you may be giving thanks well enough, but the other man is not edified. I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. But in the church, I would rather speak 5 intelligible words to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. And there it is again. Paul says, at the end of the day, you're not building anyone up. If no one can comprehend the message God gave you, you're just wasting everybody's time. And notice Paul brings himself in. Notice we saw last time, Paul has the gift of speaking in tongues. But Paul said, I would rather speak 5 words that are comprehended than 10,000 words that are not comprehended. I would rather have 5 words that may build someone up rather than stand in front of the congregation and just simply impress them with my spiritual gift but have no benefit to them. Paul says these gifts are given to serve the congregation. And if your gift does not benefit the congregation to worship, Paul says then don't use it. You need to have the ability to build up the church. They must be able to comprehend the message God has given. So here's the point. The benefit must be for others. Again, with this gift of speaking in tongues, which was for the early church, if you could not comprehend the message, Paul says it's better than not even speak at all, because the point is to build others up. Now, as I thought on that this week, there's some principles of worship that play out of this. First of all, we learn from this that worship is not about us. Worship is not about us having an experience all by ourselves. Worship is about the communal experience as the one body of Christ being built up together. And even more than that, notice, this also teaches us about those who use their gifts in worship. Often there's a lot of discussion about people who have gifts and they want to serve the church and they want to come forward in front of church. But notice Paul's point. If those gifts, and there are many gifts that are not part of public worship, if those gifts are not a part of worship, and if they don't build up the church, then they're not to be a part of public worship. There's a purpose for everything in the order of worship. And Paul says the purpose is not about your individual experience or desire to serve. It must glorify God and build others up in worship. And so there we see the first principle of orderliness. It is for the benefit of others in the congregation. Now, secondly, we're going to move on to a newer topic now. Notice that Paul also argues now that orderliness and use of gifts is for the benefit of outreach. Look at verse 20 as he notes their error in this. Verse 20, he says, "Brothers, stop being like children. In regard to evil, be infants, but in your thinking, be adults." Now there you can easily see Paul is using sharp words. He's rebuking the church. Basically what he's saying is how you're conducting worship is you're acting like little children. Paul says you've got to stop thinking like little children. If you're going to be like children in your evil, but in your thinking, in worship, act like adults. Paul in many ways is telling this church that how they're conducting worship on Sundays is immature and they need to replace what they're doing. In other words, Paul is saying your problem in worship is because of your abuse of these gifts. In that verse, Paul is basically rebuking them, saying you need to repent of what you're doing, change the way you're worshiping, and stop acting like children. Now, this is where the text I found this week got very difficult. There are numerous disagreements over this. I'm going to do my best to wade through them. But notice how Paul enters into what he calls the sign of tongues for unbelievers. Look at verses 21 and 22. He says, "In the law it is written," now he quotes from Isaiah 28 here, he says, "Through men of strange tongues and through lips of foreigners, I will speak to this people. But even then they will not listen to me, says the Lord." Now notice verse 22. "Tongues then are a sign not for believers but for unbelievers. Prophecy, however, is for believers, not for unbelievers." Paul now says how you conduct worship matters not just for you as believers, but Paul says it matters for unbelievers. Isn't that interesting? Paul assumes that there's going to be unbelievers in the congregation, and Paul says how you're worshiping is contrary, will not benefit believers. Now, how does Paul get at this? And he gets at it, and if I can confess it this way, in kind of a confusing way. Paul here quotes from Isaiah 28. In your own time, you can look up the verses here. But in the context of Isaiah 28, God is warning through Isaiah of the impending Assyrian captivity. And in that chapter, Isaiah is saying, God has sent prophets to you. They have spoken to you in your own language. You understood what the prophets said, and now God is warning you. It is a sign of judgment that you will know God now is putting judgment on you when people invade you in foreign tongues. In other words, Isaiah is saying, listen, you've had plenty enough time to hear from God, and he's used prophets who've spoken your language. And you will know it's a sign of sure judgment when you're taken over by people who have foreign tongues. In other words, Isaiah is getting at the fact that there's a sure sign of judgment when Assyria comes and they speak a foreign language, and then Israel will know that they disobeyed God. Now, the question is what does that have to do with unbelievers in worship? And to the best of my ability this week, I think what Paul is getting at is that for the sign of unbelievers, or for the speaking in tongues is a sign for unbelievers, I think what he's getting at is a sign of judgment. In other words, Paul says, when you're speaking in tongues, and we know that that's primarily what they were doing, and an unbeliever comes in and you're speaking in a language these unbelievers cannot comprehend, Paul says, for them, that's a sign of judgment. Now, how does that play out? Well, I think this is what Paul means. It's a sign of judgment because they are left in their sin. A message is taking place in front of them that they can't comprehend, and they leave and they have no understanding of their sin. They have no understanding of God's plan of redemption. They have no understanding of the way of salvation because the message was held back from them. And so I think what Paul is getting at is a sign of judgment for unbelievers, or speaking in tongues rather, is that it doesn't benefit them and it leaves them in the judgment of their sin. Now, I'm going to bolster my argument there from verse 23. Notice how he adds to this. He says, "So if the whole church comes together and everyone speaks in tongues, and some who do not understand or some unbelievers come in, will they not say that you are out of your mind?" And so here's the point. Paul says, when all you're doing is speaking in tongues, these unbelievers will come in, and they're going to leave, and they're going to say, these people are crazy. They have no idea what's going on. No one has any understanding of what that person just said. Everyone's speaking their own language. And Paul says, or I think what Paul is getting at, is you leave that person in judgment. Like Israel in the Old Testament, the sign of judgment that God was against them was a message that they could not understand from the Assyrians. And I think what Paul is getting at here is that for unbelievers, you will leave them in their state of judgment when they cannot comprehend the message in the speaking of tongues. Now again, let me just comment that this passage is extremely difficult. I commend to you your own study. If you have a study Bible, there may be a list of other views. But to the best of my ability this week, I do think that is what Paul is saying. Now, notice now how Paul says then, prophecy is preferred for the sake of outreach. Look at verse 24. He says, but if an unbeliever or someone who does not understand comes in while everybody is prophesying, he will be convinced by all that he is a sinner and will be judged by all, and the secrets of his heart will be laid bare, so he will fall down and worship God, exclaiming, God is really among you. You see, that's why I think that's what Paul is getting at. Paul says prophecy is preferred because for unbelievers who attend worship, they can comprehend the message. When God speaks through that prophet, there's a message of salvation, and that sinner can understand that, and God may lead that person to repentance. And so, again, it's a little confusing, but at the end of the day, however you understand these verses, the outcome or the application is the same. Paul says you are to think about unbelievers in your midst. The worship service must be discernible enough that an unbeliever sitting in the pew will hear the gospel, be told that they're sinners, be told that there's a way of salvation, and that they need to repent, and that must be understandable. And if it's not understandable, Paul says you're leaving them in a state of everlasting judgment. And therefore, Paul says, orderliness and right use of gifts must be used for the benefit of outreach. And so, speaking of tongues without an interpreter does no benefit to evangelism, but prophecy does. Now again, if you think about it, there's some implications for us in this. Again, we don't believe in speaking in tongues anymore, we don't believe in prophecy anymore, but this does teach us that Paul assumed that there were going to be unbelievers present on Sunday. Paul assumed that they would be inviting neighbors, that there would be unbelievers joining for worship. So what's the application? Well, you think about it, that part of the application is that we should have a worship service that's understandable enough that an unbeliever can follow along in what we're doing. For me personally, part of the application is making sure that it's orderly enough and that they know where to turn in the Bible, that they know what book to use so they can join in, and that we are understandable enough that unbelievers walk away at least knowing what we believe and why we believe it. Again, at the end of the day, Paul assumed that there were going to be unbelievers in attendance, and the church is to take that into consideration with how they structure their worship. Now, thirdly and finally then, Paul takes another turn in topic, and notice how he ends with benefit of order. Paul literally commands them now with how they are to structure their worship service. Look at the chaotic service, again, that he notes in verse 26 for this. He says, what then shall we say, brothers? When you come together, everyone has a hymn or a word of instruction, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation. All of these things must be done for the strengthening of church. You see, there Paul again brings everything back to its point. What was going on in the church in Corinth was absolute chaos. One person would have a hymn that they'd be shouting over another. Another person had a tongue they wanted to bring. Everyone was doing their own thing, pushing and shoving. And Paul says it's absolute chaos. When you gather for worship on Sunday, Paul says, you must have an order to it. There must be a structure to it so that it will strengthen the church. Absolute chaos, in other words, doesn't benefit others. It doesn't strengthen the church. Therefore, they are to have a predetermined order. Now, here's the order. This is where I'm going to really summarize and bring everything together. Notice how Paul corrects the order in three ways. One, he corrects their order in speaking of tongues. Look at verse 27. He says, if anyone speaks in a tongue, two or at most three should speak, one at a time, and someone must interpret. If there is no interpreter, the speaker should keep quiet in the church and speak to himself and to God. Paul says, how are you to get structure? Well, Paul says, let's begin with speaking in tongues. If any are present with a gift of speaking in tongues, two, or at most three, should be allowed to speak. And only those who have an interpreter present. Paul says, you're not allowed to continue with this nonsense if someone's speaking and no one able to understand. If someone has a message but no one can interpret, Paul says, have that person sit down. Let them speak to God alone, but he's no benefit to the public worship service, and so have him sit down. And Paul says, make sure it's orderly. Make sure they're one at a time and not too many. Again, what's Paul's point? Be orderly. Be structured in how you do worship. Otherwise, it will not be beneficial to the church. Second correction, he corrects them with their use of prophecy. Verse 29. He says, two or three prophets should speak, and the others should weigh carefully what is said. And if a revelation comes to someone who is sitting down, the first speaker should stop. For if you can all prophesy in turn, so that everyone may be instructed and encouraged. Paul says the structure is the same. If someone has the gift of prophecy, there's an order to it. There's an orderly nature to how you do this. Again, they are to prophesy in order. Each is to take their turn. Paul says you're not to be speaking over one another. Bring someone forward, let them give the message, and then, notice this, weigh carefully what is said. Likely elders would come forward and give the understanding of the word of God. Now, what I don't understand, to this day, I don't know why he says this, but Paul says, if someone else has a newer prophecy, the person who's speaking should sit down. Now, to the best of my understanding, I'm not sure why that is. Maybe it's a newer prophecy. Maybe God has something more to say through that person. But the point is this. Paul says there's an orderliness to it. If someone has a new revelation suddenly, the person who is speaking should sit down. And the third one, and this is the most difficult, most controversial one, Paul corrects women's involvement in worship. Look at verse 33. It says, as in all the congregations of the saints, women should remain silent in the churches. They are not allowed to speak, but must be in submission, as the law says. If they want to inquire about something, they should ask their own husbands at home. For it is disgraceful for a woman to speak in the church. Now this text, as you can imagine, has been very controversial, especially over the debate of women in office. But especially in our own study of 1 Corinthians, this text is extremely difficult because if you remember back in chapter 11, we had the two sermons about women wearing head coverings for the very purpose of prophesying in the church. So the question is, okay, Paul, you say women should not speak in church, but in chapter 11, you said women should prophesy with head coverings. Which is it? Well, again, I'm going to have to humbly say, to the best of my ability, we're not clear on all the circumstances, but this is what I think Paul is getting at. Paul is saying to women who have the gift of prophecy, they are allowed to come forward and give that prophecy, but I think he's saying that men are the ones who are to give the understanding of it. That fits with other parts of the Bible in 1 Timothy, where Paul says women are not to be teachers in the church. And so I think what's going on here is Paul is saying women who have the gift of prophecy can give that, but they're not allowed to give the understanding of the teaching of the prophecy, in other words. Now, again, other people give other views, and I think some of them have some validity to them. Perhaps some women in the church were causing disorder. Perhaps they were interrupting, and Paul says you've got to stop that. If you want to interrupt and find out the understanding, go home and ask your husband. But either way, notice what Paul is saying here. There's a predetermined order in who gets to speak. Women can prophesy, but Paul seems to say here, they cannot give the understanding that is left up to the elders of the church. At least, to the best of my understanding, I do believe that is what Paul is getting at. Again, what is Paul's point? There's a predetermined plan for how the structure of worship takes place before you get to church on Sunday. This is how things are to take place. Last thing to note then, notice that this order is commanded by God. Look at verse 37. He says, if anybody thinks he is a prophet or spiritually gifted, let him acknowledge that what I am writing to you is the Lord's command. If he ignores this, he himself will be ignored. Notice that Paul says this orderliness in worship, my commands are not my personal preference. What I've just given to you, says Paul, comes from God himself. Paul even says, if anyone among you does not regard this, you are to ignore that person. This comes from God. It's God's worship service. It's God's church. And therefore, Paul says, these are commands straight from God that your worship services must be orderly. They must be structured. There must be for the benefit of others and for the outreach of the church. You must do these things because this is the will of God who is head of the church. And the reason is because it reflects God's character. Again, one last reading here. Notice verses 33 and 39 and 40. Verse 33 says, "For God is not a God of disorder, but of peace." And then 39, "Therefore, my brothers, be eager to prophesy, and do not forbid speaking in tongues. But everything should be done in a fitting and orderly way." In other words, Paul says, the reason I gave these commands from God is this. God is a God of order, not of chaos. God is the God who at creation brought order and design from chaos. He's a God, notice, Paul says, of peace, not disorder. And when you come together and you're fighting over one another, you're pushing and shoving, you're bringing disorder, you're bringing lack of peace, and that does not please God. And so Paul says, in order to please God, your worship has to be structured, and you are to do the commands that Paul has laid out. In other words, this is not Paul's preference. This is God's command. And Paul says you are not to apologize for order. It is the way you glorify and serve God when you have an orderly structure to your worship service. And so in the end, order of worship benefits others. It benefits outreach, and it benefits the building up of the church altogether. Now, in conclusion then, what is the application from a confusing text like this? Three things that I want to leave you with. First of all, I think the clear principle that we learn from this is that worship is a blood-bought privilege. You know, as we dealt with all chapters with gifts, and especially chapter 14 with all of these gifts, at the end of the day, all of this is possible for one reason. God has redeemed the church to be his bride. Everything Paul is about drives home this implication. Why do we worship? Because Christ has died to buy a bride for himself. Why do we worship? Because we've been bought from our sin and our guilt, and we have been brought into God's kingdom. Why do we worship? Because we're no longer in the kingdom of darkness, but God has brought us into the kingdom of life. Everything Paul is about here brings us back to the foot of the cross. Worship, brothers and sisters, is a blood-bought privilege. What we do here on Sunday is assemble with the saints who have gone before us and the angels in heaven, and we are worshiping the God who loves us. We are singing praises to the King of Kings. We are hearing him speak from his word. Worship is a heavenly reality. And Paul is driving home that what we do is a privilege. Again, we're reminded that whether it's prayer, whether it's praising God in song or listening to a sermon, it is only possible because of God's wondrous grace. It is the cross of Calvary that has redeemed and transformed us from being God-haters to God-worshippers. And even more than that, if you think about it, this is what we were created for. When we are sitting under a sermon, when we are singing praises, when we are worshiping and fellowshipping, it's all about what we were created for, the purpose of our existence. And Paul says it's a blood-bought privilege. Take very seriously, congregation, he says, what you do for the sake of God who purchased you. So first of all, we learned this morning, or this evening rather, that worship is a blood-bought privilege that we are to prize. Do you prize worship? Do you prize the moments that we have here, the two sermons on Sunday? Paul says it's a result of grace and a little taste of heaven. Secondly, we also learn from this text the reason that we are to have orderly worship. And you notice that we, in the Reformed tradition especially, we have an order of worship. If you have your bulletins open, you can turn to the back of it. Pastor Jeremy Veldman wrote that years ago to give an explanation for why we do what we do. We have an order of worship. This was a principle that the Reformers rediscovered that we call the regulative principle of worship. In other words, here at this congregation, we believe what we do in worship must be commanded by God. We're not allowed to do whatever we may want to do. We're only allowed to do what God expressly commands. And so, by humility and God's direction, we do the best we can to have a purpose for all that we do. And if you notice in the back of your bulletin, each part of our order of service has a biblical reason for what we do. Now, there's numerous orders of service. There's other ways to do this. But this is our goal of being obedient to this text. That when we gather together, there's an orderliness. That everything is being done in a fitting and orderly way to reflect the character of our God. So we learn this evening that the reason we do what we do is trying to be faithful to this text and have an orderly way of worship. Thirdly, it also teaches us worship is not only for believers, but also for unbelievers. And I just mentioned that because that stood out to me. As I pondered this text over the week, it stood out to me that Paul says we are to have a concern for the unbelievers in our midst. Worship, of course, is for believers. But Paul says, have in mind the unbelievers and then make sure that they are able to understand the gospel. Paul clearly assumes that they would be present and welcomed in the worship service. So what does that mean by way of implication for us? I think for us, we should not assume that everybody who joins us for worship on Sunday knows what's happening. I think we should have our eyes open for visitors and to note them, to assist them if they don't know which book to turn to, which hymnal. We're to have our eyes open to assist unbelievers so that they are able to follow along as best they can. And as well, I think that teaches us that our worship should be simple and clear so that even unbelievers are able to understand what is going on. But in summary, what is the point? The point is we are to do things orderly for the glory of God, for the building up of the church. And by God's grace, may we continue to do that. Amen. Let's pray. Our gracious God and our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Father, even a text that stretches us, we thank you for that. We ask, O Lord, send your Spirit. Father, we pray that he would grant us understanding, that he would grant us the application. And Father, even now as we go from here into the week ahead, Father, send us out as your servants, serving you faithfully in all that we do. And we ask this in Christ's name alone. Amen.